Hello and welcome to another deep dive. So this time around, we're going to be taking a look at something called an audio mixer. So we've previously in Unity looked at audio sources and audio listeners, where we can set up some basic audio there for being able to play things. And at the time mentioned that we have this idea of audio mixers, and that allows us to do a more sophisticated setup. And that's what we're going to be looking at today. So audio, just using base audio source and audio listener is fine for if we've got a very simple setup, if we're not working with too many sounds, and in particular not working with too many different sort of categories of sounds where we might be needing to do different things with them. As soon as we are, then we need to look at some more powerful setups there that are going to make it easier for us to work with. And that's where audio mixers come in. So first thing I'm going to do, and I already have some sound effects and everything in here from the audio tutorial, the earlier video there. So some sound effects generated in BFXR and a background music from a game of mine. So first thing I'm going to do is I'm going to create an audio mixer. So this is going to be my default mixer. So the audio mixers are an asset. We don't add them into the scene. And if I double click on the mixer, then I can actually edit it, which I'm going to move this over here. So the first thing we'll see is we have these groups. And by default, what we have is one group there, which is referred to as master. That's the control for the overall volume. And now you might have seen in many games where you have a control that lets you set the overall volume, but then you can also customize things like the sound effect volume or the music volume or the voiceover volume. And that's where groups come in, because under this group here, we can create a child group. For example, sound effects. I could create another one that is for music. So these give us different groups, and they what we do with our audio is we actually route our audio to a particular group. So if in the scene I add in a 3D object, and this is going to be my SFX emitter. So we know this is going to need a source. What we'll see with the audio source is we have this output option. And we can actually choose which group an audio source goes to. So in this case, this is going to emit to the sound effect source. So any audio that we play will come to this group. And the way the groups work is things sent to a child group then actually get emitted up to the parent. So we'll see. I'm going to set up script just to randomly play between different sounds. So I'm going to have a SFX emitter, which what this will do is I'm going to give it a list of audio clips. So it's going to have a set of audio clips, audio clip, and I'm going to have this be just called my sound effects. I want to have a interval between those sound effects. Interval, which I'm going to default that to 2 seconds. And then what I'm also going to have is I need to keep track of the next effect time, which I'm going to start at 0. And that looks pretty good. I don't need to have a serialized field version of my audio source. I do need to link to the audio source. But what I will do there is I will say require component. So I'm a strong believer in using things like require component, because it's making it that we're preventing errors. In that by using require component, I can't attach this script to something that doesn't have an audio source. So it's just a way of enforcing that rule that this script is working under. So it's just a really good sort of approach there. Because it means I can safely here do a get component of my audio source, relying on the fact that, yep, this will always be able to retrieve it. So then in update, Next effect time. Update that. Time to play audio. So F next effect time is less than or equal to 0. Then I need to pick the clip. So the selected effect is going to be sound effects, random range, from 0 to sound effects count. Then I will be able to play that. So I'll be able to say, hey, link source, play one shot. And here's the selected effect. And then the next effect time is going to be my interval plus I get that clip's length. So it's just going to be playing it at that particular rate. So it enforces the interval, but the interval doesn't actually start until we've finished playing the particular effect. So that gives us a decent setup there, and we can add that onto our SFX emitter. So we'll add in that script. So we can link up our sound effects. I'll just lock the inspector, grab all of my sound effects in one go, and drag those in. So that's cool. So let's see. We play this, and we can see it's playing, and we can see our volumes. Now, if I want to adjust this, I can turn on edit and play mode, and I can actually just make changes here. Because I can rebalance this and be like, yeah, no, I want the sound effects to always be a bit quieter. So it's an easy way of being able to actually control these and adjust them, because that setting change is remembered. So we can play the audio. I can see the intensity of the relative different ones, which is great. Because if I then chuck in my background music, so background music, and in this case, I'm just going to make this a really simple setup where it's going to link to music, going to link to the track, make that loop. Let's play this, and we'll be able to see that music is going to fade in. And so the music volume, I might want to adjust that a bit as well. So we can turn on edit and play mode. We can bring that down. So maybe we want that to be more like minus 20 as well. And I can see what happens with changing the main volume. Because as said, that main volume, that's an overall control. So the each individual one we can adjust the volumes for, but we can also make it that we adjust the overall volume. So that's pretty cool. You know, we haven't needed to do actually anything different really in the way of coding from what we've previously done for working with audio to have stuff play through the mixes. It's a very straightforward setup for linking to it. But we can actually do more than this. We can do some really sophisticated setups. So you might have noticed in some games, in particular ones where there is voiceover, where there's dialogue, that when a character's speaking, it actually, the game might lower music or it might lower sound effects. So it changes the intensity of those. So that's a process known as ducking. And what we can do with the mixer is we can actually make it that one of these groups will duck based upon sounds being played on another group. So it means we don't need to hard code in anything or set up any logic for, oh, well, we're playing dialogue now, let's lower the volume. We can just set it up visually. So how this works is on our one that we want the volume to be lowered on. So in this case, the music. I go to add, and then I add in duck volume. And we'll see, the first thing we'll be saying is that, well, there's no send sources connected. Because the way this works is I actually have to send the audio from whatever channels I want to be, or whatever groups I want to be able to activate that ducking. So in SFX, if I add in a send, so I can say, I want it to send it to duck volume. And we can actually control the intensity that it will get sent at. By default, it's going to send it essentially at 0. But we can ramp this up. So if we change that to 0, it means What we are providing as the input into the duct volume effect is the intensity exactly as it is from the sound effects channel. And then if we play this, the debug display here is really handy. We can see where it's reaching in terms of that input intensity. And we can see it's very faint, but we have our threshold here. And so the ducking doesn't kick in until we hit that threshold. So we can see, okay, how close is it getting to hitting that? And we can actually then change our threshold. So if I bring my threshold way down, then the ducking actually has a chance to kick in. I'm going to lower this down to more like minus 60. And we can control how quickly that ducking happens and how quickly it recovers. So our attack and release time, the attack time is how quickly it's going to start doing that fading. And then the release time is how quickly it's going to return back. So this allows us to adjust that ducking very easily and adjust the different characteristics of it. You know, we've got different parameters that we can adjust here as well. So it means that it's really, really easy. And we can see visually the volume. As soon as a sound effect is playing here, it's lowering the music volume. So super easy to set up just little things like that, having ducking happening. And it's all done visually. It takes us, you know, 30 seconds, a minute to hook it up. And then we can tweak and adjust and balance it. Really great setup for it. So mixers make working with this stuff really easy. And we can do more than this. And so this is just scratching the surface so far. We've got our different controls here. We're playing audio coming from different sources and going through different channels. But one of the things we've seen in games is this idea of being able to control the volume for each of these things independently. So we can set an overall volume. We can set a sound effect volume, a music volume. And we can do that very easily with the mixers as well. The process is a little bit weird in that it's going to look a little bit different to what we're used to seeing in terms of how we access parameters like of this, but it's very straightforward for us setting it up. So first thing I'm going to do is I'm going to create my UI for this. So I want to have a panel. This is going to be my audio controls. And what I want to have is just that sort of fairly familiar setup of my three, in this case, main audio controls. So let's adjust this so we are positioned appropriately. 400 wide, it's a decent size there, and 300. And then under this, I just want to have in, I'm going to have a few different labels and other controls here. So I'm going to have my label and a slider. So I'm just going to duplicate these and neatly organize them using a vertical layout group, where I'm not going to force expand the child's height, but I will expand the width. Set up a little bit of padding here, just so we've got some nice spacing between these. We can increase our text size a bunch. It's looking pretty good. Let's make the sliders a bit bigger as well, just so it's a bit friendlier to work with. So that's pretty cool. So let's adjust these labels here. So volume label, this is the overall volume label, this is the overall volume. So I think it's, you know, I've said this before, but I think it's really important to make sure that we are naming things in the hierarchy here. It's a really good habit to get into, in that once you're into that habit, then you're not really thinking about it. It's just an automatic aspect of what you're doing. And it just means that on a large project, it ends up being a lot easier for working with. Otherwise, it's really easy to get sort of lost in the weeds with stuff. And we want to try and avoid that. Because you can end up with things, you know, if you're trying to work out, is changing a setting, it's like, well, is it Is it label one, label one, label one, or label one? You know, if you've got duplication like that, it's messy. We want to avoid things like that. So sound, effect, volume, and music volume. So that's good. Now, we're changing the attenuation here, and we can see our attenuation goes from 20 to minus 80. So what I'm going to do with my sliders is my slider here, I'm going to set the min value to minus 80, the max to 20. So it's just covering that full range and the default value of 0. So that looks pretty good. In my scripts then, I can set up a script for my audio controls. So this is going to be doing a couple of things. One of the things it's going to be doing is it's going to need to link to the mixer to be able to ask the mixer for the volume of things. I'm going to need to bring in Unity Engine Audio. And then I want to have my audio mixer, so target mixer. Now I know I also have my sliders that I'm going to need to be able to control. So I need unityengine.ui. Good. I'm going to have my slider for overall volume. I'm going to have a slider for SFX volume. And let's also chuck in a slider for music volume. Now, the other thing I'm going to do, because I want to be able to have this display really nicely, is I'm also going to chuck in a link for the labels. That way then what I can do is in the actual label itself, I can say, yes, the overall volume is currently, and then indicate the particular value. So I've got sound effects volume, and then let's do this with music volume. So that's good. I'm going to have all of those. And I know I'm going to need functions for on overall volume changed. So that's going to have a new value. And I'm going to have a similar setup for each of these. So I will have a on SFX volume changed, and I will also have a on music volume changed. So, okay, and I could update the labels at this point, because what I could do is, okay, overall volume label, text, and that might end up being overall volume, new value, and I can control how new value comes through. So I could say to string, and if I go for saying, yeah, if I look at this with the sliders, we do have the option of making it be whole numbers. And I think we only need it to be whole numbers. 100 different values there is, I think, enough. So we can just actually say that this is going to, what I would probably do in that case then is, I could just use the to string. We're going to say like of that, a 0. So we want to update each of the labels. So what we're going to do is we're going to test that the UI is working before we actually test the changing of the volumes, because there is a little bit of a trick to how we have to change those volumes. Because the mixer does have a set float, get float, things like of that, but we need to know the names of the ones to refer to. And that's what we're going to be taking a look at, of how we actually get those names. So first, let's make sure this is working in terms of we've got our controls and everything linked up, so I can link to my mixer. Now, this is where having these labels and everything properly named makes this process of linking up really straightforward. because I am able to easily find the things in my list, and that makes that much quicker and easier. So then I can link these for having the value changed, so they can link over to, in this case, my overall music volume changed. And because I've got multiple ones going to the same script, I want to be really careful and make sure I'm selecting the right one. So in this case, we're changing the sound effect volume, and I need to be careful of that as well, of making sure I don't select the static one. I want the dynamic one. So the current value is what actually comes through there. So we link up then our music one. Cool. So this won't change anything at the moment, but we just want to check that our UI is behaving the way we expect. And we can see that, yep, yeah, we've got that displaying fairly nicely. Now, minus 80 might not be a great value for sort of showing there. So we could wrap this, and actually I would set up generally a constant here. Min audio volume, or maybe audio volume UI offset, and add that in. Just so we're showing a 0 to 100 range, because that's one where we could then easily, you know, people could easily interpret that as being a percentage, things like of that. But we know that's working. Now we just need to link it up to the mixer. And actually, linking it up to the mixer is the quickest part of it. So the way we have to do this to be able to change something is we select the group. Then over here, you can see we've got attenuation. I can right click here and say expose volume. And I can do that for each of these. Expose volume, and then here in exposed parameters, can see we've got our different ones, and I can rename them here. So this is my overall volume. This is my music volume. And then this one is my SFX volume. So it's a bit of a different way of working with this. We're not used to having to go through this extra step of saying, no, expose this parameter. But it is a thing that we need to do with the mixers. So we can just, and there's a lot of things that we can do that with. You'll find a lot of the entries and like the pitch changes, stuff like that, can be exposed in this manner. Because now that we have those exposed and we have them with specific names, what we can do is very easily then say, okay, well, target mixer, set float, overall volume, new value. And we do the same for each of these, just using the appropriate name, music volume. And then in start, because we want those sliders to start based upon where things currently are at, well, we can say, hey, overall volume, your value, we can override that. And if we, what we'll find though with the target mix is if we do target mixer get float, it actually works as this method for using an out parameter, and it returns a Boolean indicating whether it found the particular thing. So volume value is how we use this, is we'd say F target mixer get float overall volume, and then we give it out volume value. Then we can say overall volume value equal to volume value. So because those names might not exist, this just gives us a way of the mixer can check and see if it actually exists. So if we hadn't exposed one of the parameters, then when we try and get it, it would return false and it wouldn't try and do anything with that particular value. So if it returns true from the get float, then we know the value has been validly retrieved. So this is our music volume. And music volume. Cool. So let's test this out. Got this there. Could have it running. And we can see our volumes have updated. Overall volume didn't because its value was already at zero. So if I changed all of these, what I would probably do then in that case is these sliders. Let's just position all of them so they're at minus 80, which is unlikely to be a value that we would have there. And we'll see, values are all populated. And what we can do is if we watch as we change this, then down here in the group, it changes. So it gives us a really, really easy way for being able to give our, you know, the players of our games, to give them controls over the volumes for things. So really straightforward, really simple to add in. If we were doing this with just only audio sources, it is still doable, but it's not as quick and easy and clean a setup as it is when we're using the mixers. So really, really powerful setup with the mixers. And we can do more than this. So let's do more than this. I'm going to set up a plane that is going to be the ground, because one of the things that we might want to do in our game is have different audio kick in at different stages of the game. Well, not different audio effects kick in at different stages of the game. So what I'm going to do is my sound effect emitter is going to just be here on the ground like that. And then what I'm going to do is just set up a couple of materials for things. That sound effect emitter. This is going to be for that. And let's just make that bright green. Actually, no, I'm going to make it orangey color. That looks better. Then let's set up our material for the ground. And we'll make that a darkish green color. There we go. So what I want to be able to do is I want to kick in some different behaviors with stuff. And this is something that we're actually able to do quite effectively with this. We can change different parameters here. We can create sort of presets for them, which it refers to as snapshots. So we can rename this one as default. And this one, you can see it's got our asterisk. It's the starting snapshot. That's the configuration the game will be in when this mixer becomes active. But we can set up other snapshots here. So we might want to have another snapshot that we can do all manner of things. So this one might be inside cave, for example. So we could have different configurations here for it. Now we can't have different effects. This is an important thing with this. We can't set up so we've got a different set of effects that play when we're inside the cave versus outside of that. What we can do is we can have some different strengths of effects though. So we can add an effect here and we could add in a whole bunch of different ones. Let's say maybe when we are in the cave, maybe we want to do a bunch of pitch shifting. And so we can easily sort of test what these effects sound like initially by we will just have it play and edit in play mode. So we can say, okay, in here, that's going, we can see how it's sort of changing the pitch. We can change it the other way. It's going to make the pitch really high. Let's lower that down. So that's a nice change there. We can hear that sort of effect kicking in. So that could be our default, but actually what we probably want to do is make it that the default is one, but inside the cave, let's bring it right down. We could configure other effects here as well. And this is something where we can do all this while we're playing, which makes it really easy to test and adjust these. So, okay, We're playing, I can switch snapshot as well while we're running. So it's in the default one at the moment. If I click on inside, then it switches to that. So easy way of testing the different effects. So if we want to adjust and have different effects in these different scenarios, you know, we've already got the pitch shifting there. We can do other ones. We can see the kinds of effects that we could be creating here. For example, one of the ones we could add in echo. Lots of different things. If we set up the echo one, that one's actually a really interesting one, in that what we will find with that is, so we're in the default, the echoing is happening. If we edit in play mode, the inside cave one, that's fine, but the default one here, we're actually pretty limited in that here. I can lower the delay, but I can't fully sort of turn off the echo. I'll still get some level of echo happening there, which is not really ideal. So what we can do, and this is a thing we might want to do for a bunch of different effects, because we can't actually switch off having a particular effect. But what we can do usually is we can do a setup like this, where what we end up doing is our sound effects here. We can create another group. So I would create a sibling group. So SFX, and this could be cave effects. And then what I could say is, well, my SFX one here, then I want something where I can do a send, and the cave effects one can have a receive effect, where what happens is SFX can send its output to the cave effects one. So then I could remove my pitch shifting from this. And what I would say is, well, in default, it's sending it with minus 80, so it's effectively sending nothing. But when it's inside the cave, it's sending it at the full intensity. And then in the cave effects one is where I could configure things like, we'll have the echo in there. I could have the pitch shifting happening, which I can change the order that these happen in as well. So we can see we can change all sorts of cool setups here with this. So we then, with the pitch shifting, that in inside cave is going to pitch it down. So we can see our SFX one in default is sending it at zero, but when we're inside the cave, it sends it with its full intensity. So it means we can have those effects effectively only kick in when we're inside the cave. So SFX stuff is playing as normal. Switch to play mode. When we're inside the cave, we get our echoing happening. So it allows us to control and adjust those effects really easily. So that's pretty cool. We've got different snapshots. What if we want to change between those? Because we might want to have it that based upon where something is in the world, we add in or we switch to those different snapshots. And that's something that the mixers make really, really easy. It's actually a very, very straightforward setup for this. So I'm going to create a script here that I'm going to call my audio snapshot volume. So the idea behind this is it's going to be a volume that when you enter or exit it, it can switch between different effects. So what I'm going to do, so I'm going to say system serializable. We also need using the engine audio. So I want to have here, this is going to be snapshot config. What we will have is the audio mixer snapshot array. So snapshots. We also have weights, and then we have our transition time. Then how we actually use that is we'll set up the configs for that. Serialize field, snapshot config. So I like to do this of setting up little sort of helper classes when I've got a group of things that I'm needing to configure multiple versions of it. It just makes it a lot cleaner and neater than if we were trying to have unique variable names for each one. So it makes it a much cleaner setup. I might also want to control what tags this reacts to. So a list of strings. Tags. Then I would have my onTriggerEnter, apply to other. And what I would say is, well, okay, if tags contains other dot tag, and we have an onEntry one, then transition to onEntry. And then onTriggerExit is going to be almost identical. So onTriggerExit, similar setup. We transition to the onExit one. OnExit. We're also going to need the mixer that we are targeting. Audio mixer linked mixer. Then the way we actually do this transition is really simple. It's an excellent setup with the audio mixers for being able to do this. So snapshot config. All we have to do, because you might be thinking, oh, well, okay, we've got to track over time and say the percentage of how far through. No, we don't. All we do is we say, hey, linked mixer, I want you to transition to some snapshots. Here is the snapshots that you are doing a transition between. So your current one and your target one, you can provide multiple. So more than just two, you can provide like three, four, however many you need. So if you're moving from a cluster of snapshots, if you wanted to change the weighting of all of them, you can do that really easily. So config weights, and then config transition time. So it means that we're not just able to, you know, switch out one snapshot. We can really easily adjust the settings there. It's very, very straightforward, very effective setup for it. Because what that means is I can then create a cube. I'm going to position this cube here. Let's make it a bit larger. Make it like that. Position up here. That's pretty good. So the idea is going to be when I enter into that cube, I want to switch from the default snapshot to the inside cave one. So cave, and actually cave audio volume would be a more accurate name for it. And let's give it an appropriate material. So material map audio volume. Is this will be, I'd usually go for a transparent one just so that then can easily sort of see that, yeah, it's not a collider, because this, we don't want it to be a collider, we want it to be a trigger. We can add in our snapshot volume script. Let's try that again, this time with more success. So we've got that added in. So tags, well, let's react to the player. And for our on entry, on exit, well, we're going to have two snapshots because that's all we've got. And so, okay, we want to have default as always being the first one. So we want to transition to it being a zero waiting for default and a waiting of one for the cave. We want that to happen over, let's say, 5 seconds. But then on exit, we'll keep the same ordering for consistency. We're going to go to default as full waiting and inside as zero. Let's transition that quicker. We can link to our mixer. So it's going to react to if something called player moves through it. So let's create a capsule that can be our player. So give this the tag of player, and we will give it a rigid body, but we're going to turn off gravity and so that we can just control its movement. And what we're expecting to see happen is as the player enters, that we see it's switching over to using the cave effects. So let's run this. So it's running, switch to scene view. So effects are playing as normal. Now let's head over into the cave and we can see stuff is now coming through from the cave effects. And if we select our SFX one and we keep that focused, and we'll lock that just so I can select the player, and then we move out of it, you can see moves down from being anything from in the cave, head back in, ramps back up again. So really easy way of us being able to configure different setups, different behaviors there based upon where the player happens to be at that particular point in time. So that's the key bits with mixers. So to recap, audio mixers are a way of giving us more control and easier control over how our sounds come through in the game. It allows us to very easily group our sounds into different categories and then to control how that category as a whole behaves. So we always have a master group that's essentially our overall volume. Everything will go through that eventually. But these are hierarchical, so we can set up children under that. So we'd have common children of things like a sound effect or music, but we can also set up special ones for if we want to be applying different additional effects there. So we can do things like adding an echo, shifting the pitch. We also saw we can do things like having one group duck, so lower its volume in response to something playing in another group. So a really great way of being able to customize, control, balance our audio very effectively there. In terms of integrating all of that, you know, things like the ducking, we were able to set that up without actually changing any code. And that's the big benefit we get with the mixers, that we can do a lot of stuff without having to touch any code. That transition that I have happening when it goes into the cave, if I want to change the effects there now, I don't need to touch any code. I just configure things on this cave effects group so I can adjust and do further things there if I needed to, no code. And this is something that makes it really powerful for customizing the audio side there. And you know, we saw that I can set up my volume controls, and to do that, I need to remember and expose the parameters. So it's a bit of a unique way of how it works, that I have to select the particular group that holds the parameter I'm wanting to expose, and then I can right-click in the inspector and choose to expose it. But it gives it just a default name, so I have to actually then come to the expose parameters, and I can rename them so that I'm making sure those are the appropriate value. I can retrieve and work with those in code very easily so I can get them, which will give me back a true or a false if it was able to retrieve it. And I can also set them very easily. So really straightforward for working with them, for getting and setting. For having different things route through our audio mixer, it's as simple as linking up as we saw with our SFX emitter, we just link up the output. That's all we need to do. We just set the output, and then that is going to mean it will go through that group in the mixer. So we can adjust then as it's playing on different volumes of things if we want, very effectively. We can have different configurations of our values. So we can't switch on and off different effects, but we can have different sets of values that allow us to have, you know, a different configuration for inside or outside the cave. And although we can't set up different effects, what we can do is we can route the audio differently. So we can use send and receive effects here to control how much audio gets sent to another group, that group might only get activated within a particular area to cause different effects to be playing. So although a snapshot doesn't directly support adding and removing effects, we can get a similar behavior to that by using this approach of setting up another group and routing the audio to that. So it's a really, really handy setup here. So I highly recommend experimenting, having a look at the audio mixer setup. It's a really great setup. It doesn't add very much in the way of code. And actually, if you were trying to do a lot of these things without using the mixer, it would be a lot more work and a lot more code. So for a very small amount of extra additional work, you can easily have your volume menus. You can then easily control your soundscape for your game and really make that as effective as possible. So experiment with it, dive into using audio mixers, look at how you could apply this to some of the other projects that we've worked with, and see the kinds of cool things that you could be doing there with it. Thanks, folks. If you're looking for the code for the project, then in the description below, you'll find a link to the GitHub. And on the GitHub, I've got the code for this project and for all of the other projects there freely available. And if you have found the video helpful and you'd like to support the channel, then throwing in a like or subscribing is always a huge help. If you're looking for further ways to support, then I do have a Patreon set up, and that's going to help me keep managing to do these videos for a long time to come, which is going to help more people make cool things. And that's awesome, because that's what this is all about, is helping more people make more cool things. And that is all. Thank you.